Welcome to Digital Asset News, to get top stories in cryptocurrency digital assets and break them down to bite-sized pieces. Today, we've got some positive yet concerning reports. First up, 65% of traders on PayPal ready to use Bitcoin to pay for goods and services. And this is both great news and frightening if it was actually true. Also, Bitcoin gets 600,000 hits on the 7 trillion assets under management BlackRock website. But the real story is why they were actually tracking this. And last, we'll do a quick follow-up on the Bitcoin miners getting shut off as far as the power supply in China and how that has affected the hash rate of the Bitcoin network. Now we'll get into all that, but first, take a look what's going on in the market. So quickly, it is December 3rd, 9 o'clock a.m. in the morning, and everything's up, so it's looking pretty good. Bitcoin's at 19.3, maybe it's 19.4, maybe 20K at the end of the week. Who knows? Ethereum's above 600, and Ethereum 2.0 has been launched, and I don't see or haven't heard of any hiccups or problems, so that is a good thing. XRP is at 62 cents. Congratulations, XRP Army. Looks like it's going up again, so maybe it'll hit a dollar at some point. Who knows? Tether's rocking around 19.5 billion for the market cap. Litecoin, I tweeted this out today, and I want to congratulate all the Litecoin holders. I sold this a long time ago. And if you have held this for this much time, I mean, tip of the hat to you. Not even the founder could actually hold it that long. Charlie sold his a long time ago, and there was a reason for that. But again, all you Litecoin holders, congratulations. Chainlink's up almost at $14. And I keep seeing this like Zeus Capital nonsense on Twitter. And they're always talking about a fraud and a scam and blah, blah, blah. But I got to tell you, every time I see that ad from Zeus, I'm like, oh, that means Chainlink's going to pump. And here we are, 1.7. Bitcoin Cash, 0.2. Polkadot, up. Wow, Polkadot's almost going to hit $6. Pretty great. Cardano, 5%. I like that. Update on the Cardano staking pool. We are still going through the process. Let me tell you, it is very difficult. It's not easy whatsoever. There's a lot of things that have to be put in place, a lot of monitoring, a lot of different just everything has to be done. It has to be done in a very certain specific way and set up the right way the first time. I am not a person that just leaves things up to chance and just says, oh yeah, it's good enough. It has to be a certain way. And I'll let everybody know when it's completed. Binance Coin, rounding out the top 10 spots. So looking pretty good, nothing really fantastic moving out there. There was a pretty big pump, I think, for VeChain. It's almost gonna hit off 2 cents, that's pretty great. And then as always, I wanna take a look at how everything is comparing to Bitcoin. Of course, if you're comparing everything to Bitcoin, you wanna know if your investment, if you would've been just better just to invest in Bitcoin. Well, Ethereum's up 1%, that's pretty good. 2.7 for Polkadot, 2.8 for Cardano, hey, not too bad. And 6.9 for NEM. NEM has just been pumping radically, so good for that. 13% for VeChain, and so on and so forth. The more you get out of the top 100, the more you see more of these gains, like Elrond, what else is up there? 6.5 for Band, 9.3 for Curve DAO token, and off you go. The real question is finding those gems, and that's not my game. All right, let's jump into today's top stories. So first up, this is good and bad, and I'll explain a bit. So 65% of traders on PayPal are ready to use Bitcoin to pay for goods and services. And so what's happening here is that there was a survey put out by Mizuho Securities, and it was a very small sample, 380 PayPal users, but it gives you an overall feel of what is going on with the rest of their 346 million active users, I guess. I don't know. That's just how surveys work, but whatever. 17% of the respondents said they have already traded Bitcoin via their PayPal accounts since the firm started offering crypto in October. And as a reminder, it was supposed to be only a small rollout, and then Q1 2021 was going to be the big one. But there was so much demand, they just said, just give it all to them because it's going to be huge. Of these, the majority are the ones who showed readiness to utilize Bitcoin for purchases. The finding is significant to the extent that it bolsters Bitcoin's credentials as a viable means of payment, something that Bitcoin opponents have routinely used to discredit the digital asset. So there's a lot to break down here. First up, when they talk about these people who are ready to use this for payments, that's a bad idea. Because when you start to use Bitcoin for payments, I mean, that's great. I mean, it keeps the whole narrative of a cryptocurrency as far as Bitcoin, but it is bad for tax purposes. And this is the same thing that people were telling me when I did a video which talked about, it was an open letter to PayPal users. And a couple of people said, hey, you didn't mention the fact that every transaction that you do, as far as like Bitcoin, to pay for goods and services, is a taxable event. So you have to keep a record of all of that. And because of that fact, I was actually able to go back and put that into the video that I have hosted over at danteacherscrypto.com. And I talk about what is a taxable event and a non-taxable event. If you want to sign up for danteacherscrypto.com, there's a link in the description. It's a 100% free website. Simplifies everything. Very simple, super easy, and gives you some pretty good advice, I think. So when we talk about these things that are actually taxable, this is not something that is really well known. And right now, since it's not being offered until Q1 of 2021, PayPal really hasn't talked about it. Now, I assume that they are going to have some kind of app or some type of monitoring system so people don't get, you know, screwed in, you know, later on when they're doing their taxes, because whatever you do through PayPal, I know for 100% fact that it's going to go right to the government as far as a 1099. So they're going to know all your transactions that you're doing, and you better pay those taxes, because if not, there's going to be a nice little letter coming to you saying you owe us X, Y, and Z. So next I want to talk about this, where it says here, something that Bitcoin opponents have routinely used to discredit the digital asset, that it's not a good means of payment. They're right. It's not a good means of payment. And we're talking about taxes, that's one thing. And you can you can monitor that and, you know, have apps and they can, you know, check you and record all that stuff. But the big thing is that, and this is a big thing, and why it's actually not even a big thing later on, I'll tell you why, that if everybody on PayPal starts to use Bitcoin, Bitcoin Cash, Ethereum, or Litecoin for transactions, all 346 million users of them, we'd have a huge problem. We'd have a huge problem, and things would go off the rails. I'm going to tell you why. This is from YCharts. These are the Bitcoin average transactions fees, or BATF. And if you can see what happened here, this is 2017. Everything was cool until it's not. And you're going to get like 27 cents in 2016, 18 cents back in, you know, wherever we go, 15, 73 cents. But if you take a look at when the craziness that happened, which was December 23rd, 2017, it was $55 to send a transaction with Bitcoin. So you're trying to send $25, there's no point in that. And this is all historical data. You can all look it up. And this is what it was, I remember. And not only was it super expensive, it was super slow because there were so many transactions. So Bitcoin can't do that. Now, people will talk about the second layer solutions. Oh, they got Lightning Network and da-da-da. Well, guess what? Still not really working that hot. And that's just how it is. So right now, and this is just averages, okay? Just averages over time. You're looking at December 2nd around... it says 7:30, but I don't think it's that high. I think it just depends on how congested the network is and everything else. So it could be lower. But I mean, if you're just over here, and that was in what was still a parabolic bull run, it was a little crazy. But what do you think is going to happen when you have 346 million people and like 65% of those are like, hey, I want to use it for transactions? You're going to see this go all the way up here, and you're going to see people say, what the heck? I can't. It takes me a couple days to send Bitcoin. I thought this was supposed to be super fast. Well, now you know. But here's why it doesn't matter. And the reason is because of what was stated in this article and has been stated in numerous articles, and that is that PayPal plans to use fiat as an intermediary when users make payments to merchants in Bitcoin. So when you are purchasing Bitcoin, you're not purchasing Bitcoin, you're purchasing paper Bitcoin. And they are scooping that up through their partner at Paxos and their exchange. So like me as a vendor, I'm not going to get Bitcoin when people transact in Bitcoin. I'm going to get dollars. That's it, fiat. So when we talk about like an actual payment system, they're not going to be using Bitcoin as a payment system. They're not going to use Bitcoin Cash or Ethereum or Litecoin. It's just going to be on paper, essentially. And what they're going to give me is paper. That's it. So they're going to buy a ton of Bitcoin. And they're buying a ton. We'll get into that in a second. But to see this as an actual currency, and it's actually motive of transactions, it's not going to do that. And then what I fear is that people are going to come back and be like, oh, well, this is great because now Bitcoin can be used as a transaction. And then they're going to go and try to do that on a exchange or their Nano Ledger, if they get that far. And they'd be like, why is it so slow? What's going on? I don't understand. It's so much better at PayPal. They don't understand. It's not going through PayPal like that. It's going just as fiat. So I think people will be uninformed and they'll be blissfully happy to be ignorant about what is going on. And that's one of the reasons why I created Dan Teaches Crypto, to help people understand why it's important to custody your own crypto and digital assets. And that's why I made this. It is the first video in the first module. And again, there's gonna be a lot of people who are like, I don't care, I don't wanna do that. And that's fine. For those people, do whatever you want to. It's a free world, and I salute you, at least you're here. I'm happy for you. But for the ones that wanna know more and wanna understand that, why decentralization is a far superior option, that's why I created the website. So go ahead and check that out at the very end. And then moving down to finish up, it states PayPal bought or is buying up to 70% of all the newly minted Bitcoin since the payments giant started offering crypto in October. So between them and the Cash App or Square, they're buying more than 100% of all the newly issued virgin Bitcoin. And that's on top of everything else that just the retail person, the institutions that are actually trying to get into it. And of course, with that, I mean Grayscale. So there's a big competition. I think there's going to be a big supply crunch coming up soon. I'm surprised the price hasn't broke past 20K already, but it is what it is. So that is that portion. Now to move on, I need to just to clarify some things and verify some things. So I invited Sheehan Chandrasekara. He is a crypto CPA, and he's going to let us in and just to verify some things we're talking about. Also, I need him to answer a couple of questions that I've been getting a lot of, which one of those is, can I just take out a loan on my cryptocurrency to minimize or totally avoid taxes? So let's get Sheehan in here in the office and he'll answer all those questions.